Hello YouTube. Today, to rebound on what I said in the last hypertrophy series episode that aired last week, I'm going to start talking more about the topic of shocking the muscle. Now, shocking the muscle is something everyone has heard at least once, and most of the time it comes from pro bodybuilders. It comes from people who actually have a very good physique, people who have shown that they have the ability to build muscle, and therefore there's an authority around it. Like, it comes from people who know what they're talking about, so supposedly it shouldn't be questioned. And it's rarely questioned, to be honest. I haven't seen much videos about it, especially the type of fitness YouTubers who like to target bro science. They seem to leave that concept alone. And the reason why, in my opinion, is because A, as I said, the type of individual who actually pushed and promoted that are very well respected. For example, Arnold Schwarzenegger was a big proponent of shocking the muscle. And I think the second part is also that it falls off people's radar because they just think it's stupid and there's not much to explain. But in reality, it's a concept that contains a lot of information about volume, intensity, what works for natural and what doesn't work. So let me say here that the quote that I'm going to base most of that video on is the one by Arnold, where he says that a muscle doesn't really respond to the same thing over and over again. And this is why he wanted to shock the muscle. One thing though is that, as far as I can tell, his notion of shocking the muscle did not go hand in hand with a very high exercise selection. He wasn't a minimalist in essence, but his exercise selection was fairly small. So regardless of whether or not we believe that his PED user status makes him someone that shouldn't be followed for natural lifters, it's true that from what I can tell personally, his training wasn't bad. Like, he used compound movements, he used variations, he used isolation movements to build his physique. He was on steroids, that's no mystery at this point, but he is not what makes shocking the muscle so bad. What I'm against when it comes to shocking the muscle is what YouTube fitness or the forum culture surrounding bodybuilding made of it. And there are a lot of bodybuilders on YouTube who embody that type of thinking, where they will basically do whatever they want in the gym, they don't follow a plan, they don't abide by the rule of specificity, and they just do whatever, meaning that they'll do chest and they'll do whatever they want on chest. And one day they'll do stuff with cables, they'll do cable flies, and then another day they might do flat bench press, incline, another day they'll do dumbbells or push-ups. And they'll tell people that not only is that not an issue for building muscle, but they also will push the idea that it's very beneficial because it shocks the muscle. Because in their mind, or at least in the opinion that they try and sell to the public, they think that by doing different movements, you surprise the body and the body is forced to grow as a response. I'm going to say here that this is complete nonsense because it completely ignores the principles of volume and intensity. For example, if you come in and you do some bench press, if you want to shock the muscle, meaning that you want to put strain on the chest to the point where it's going to be forced to adapt more than it did from that bench press session, and you do push-ups, you're going to have to find a way to put as much tension on the pectoral muscles as you did with the horizontal press that the bench press represented. Most people are not going to be able to do that. Most people won't even do that. They might just do push-ups until it burns and they'll think it's good, they'll call it a day. But this did not create any amount of stress that is even close to what you got on the bench press. You need to have an intensity that is similar or higher to create that stress. This is why progressive overload is so important for natural lifters, and why the idea of shocking the muscle goes completely against that, which is why it's not something that I want to promote. There's also the idea that your muscle can tell what you're doing somehow, in the sense that if you go from, for example, a squat to a lunge, suddenly the body is going to panic because it's going to tell itself, oh, this is a completely different new movement, I better adapt. That's not how the body works. Again, your body is bones, tendons, muscle fibers. They will react to the stress that is put on them, all right? And as I explained in the hypertrophy series, yes, if you stay within the same volume and intensity forever with the same rep ranges, you're going to find that at a certain point, you won't progress anymore. It's not because your muscle refuses to progress from that. It's that you are stuck within a certain volume and intensity window that is not allowing you to progress anymore, because you need to experiment other rep ranges so that you feed the muscle different types of tonnage to keep it growing. It has nothing to do with the muscle just being used to squats. There are no expiration dates on lifts. Compound movements can be used for the rest of your lifting career to grow. You can squat for 10 years and still make progress, but you're going to have to be willing at some point to do variations, to try different volume and intensity styles, do some pose, maybe some partials here and there, because you cannot just stick to the same thing over and over again, right? But it's not the same thing as saying, oh, just don't stick to something consistently and try something new every week and you'll grow. This is actually the best way to never grow, because what's gonna happen is you're going to experiment artificial progress. Because since you're going to be jumping from lift to lift, your body is going to have to relearn how to do the lift. Even if it's a similar movement pattern, it's going to have to spend some neurological adaptation to get good at it again. So you're going to go through that technique period where you're relearning the lift, and your strength is going to shoot up, and people misconstrue that as progress. Let me tell you this, when you are in that newbie phase of a lift, where you're learning the lift, and you get super strong super fast, you're not building any muscle from this. You're just teaching the muscle fibers you already have to perform the movement. But this is not creating hypertrophy or hyperplasia. You're just stalling, if not regressing. Example, last year, I started doing SSB bar squats with a box. I started with 185. On the bar. I went from 185 to now 365 pounds within a year, less than a year. So I doubled the weight I could squat. Question, did I double the gains I make on squats? Do you think that all of that poundage, that tonnage that I gained, did that go to my quads, my glutes, and my hammies? The answer is no. Most likely the vast majority of that, a vast percentage of that progression was just me relearning the lift because it was a new lift that I had never done. And maybe you could argue that by the time I was at 300 pounds, I knew the lift, and I would say yes. But that represents a progression that is not that important. Now, if I had made the same progress on the squat, on the barbell back squat, and I had gained 180 pounds, so from 300 to 480, now that would be muscle gains. Because as you come to understand when you practice movements a ton, once you reach a point when you've practiced the movement every week for years, you've reached technical mastery. You're very close to it, meaning that you're between 95 and 100% if your form and technique is correct. You can vary from that, but you're always going to be in a very high mastery range. That, as long as you keep practicing the lift frequently enough, is never going to go down. So any amount of strength you gain, unless you change technique completely, is going to be muscle gains, right? But if you stop squatting for a year and you start again and you gain 150 pounds, that's not progress. You're just getting back what you used to have. And I will make videos about it. There is something to be told about throwbacks when it comes to tonnage, because in a sense, you are accumulating tonnage again and again in intensity windows that now are actually challenging because you lost the neurological ability to perform the lift. I've experienced that. This is why my legs are so big and my squat is so low. It's because I've hurt myself so many times on the squat that I kept doing this and then going back. So I would retake that portion of the tonnage again and again, which grew my legs, but my strength isn't that high. But that's not optimal. It's just not. Even if you don't get injured and you just, because you decide to go back in weight and retake the same portion of the tonnage again and again, you could have progressed and gotten stronger and made better gains. And it would have fed into the other lifts because your absolute strength would have went up. This is also why the idea of shocking the muscle doesn't work, because it's a circular ideology. It's a circular method of training. And unless you have a little extra something that promotes muscle growth, as long as there's activation, you're not going to go anywhere. This is why people who have too high of an exercise selection, who rotate lifts too much, they end up in limbo. Like, they make progress, but they don't really see much of a difference in physique, and they don't know why. And sometimes they manage to pull their hands out of the sand, and they realize, wow, I've actually made no progress. Because if you actually write down the lifts and the strength on the lift and the tonnage they accomplish, and you do that rotation style for a full year, go back to the notebook at the end of the year, you're going to find that the improvement you've made on lifts that you stopped practicing for 6 months, once you go back to them, it's going to be marginal. Your strength is going to have regressed. I've explained that in the hypertrophy series. This is why keeping tonnage stable is so important. But as far as the idea of the muscle doesn't really respond to the same thing over and over again, yes, it does, as long as you manipulate volume and intensity. It absolutely does. Of course, a 5x5 for the next 10 years is not going to work, because it's the same intensity window again and again, and it has its own issues. But there is more to lifting than just the lifts. And I know it's tough to grasp, because YouTube fitness is all about, oh, the new variation of that lift is going to blow you up, or the five best squat variation exercises. It's just sensational for the sake of being sensational. The most important part in that notion of shocking the muscle is going to be the weight and the variations of them. Not necessarily the style in which you do it. Of course, the variations are very important. Once you have a firm grasp on them, you need to make a choice. You need to pick a certain amount, and then the variety is going to come from what you do with them. You can't just do everything, because people who do everything are good at nothing. So that's pretty much my take on shocking the muscle. I really wanted to expand on that because it's a very important principle. And as far as bodybuilding goes, it's pretty much bodybuilder Bible 101. People talk about it all the time. So I think that's it. I don't have much to add to that. If you have any questions, let me know in the comments. Thank you for watching. Have a good day.